Like, you know, this question is one of the most common questions put by the popular detractors to Islam. And alhamdulillah, you know, recently Salam published a 7,000 word essay on our website. If you go to salam.org.uk, I actually wrote a research paper on this. I think alhamdulillah it's been very successful, it's been well received as well. And in the paper, I called it On Morality, the Marriage or the Union of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Aisha. And in this paper, I didn't even go into the hadith discussion about this. I left it. I thought it's irrelevant. We don't even need to discuss it. I'm not going to say, I could say, oh, the hadith is agreed upon, Bukhari Muslim is authentic, you know, and I keep going to the scholars of India and the hadith in how they say, no, the hadith is weak. Okay, that. I thought, you know what, there's no need to even discuss that. Leave that. They don't care about that, right? Whoever's saying this don't care about the hadith, right? Why are we going to kind of, you know, accept the objection? So in the paper, I basically went through morality and our concept of morality. You know, how do we know when something is good? How do we know when something is bad? Okay, is it objective morality or not? Is it relative? And of course it's relative. If you say it's objective, as was mentioned by Immanuel Kant and others, that there is objective good and evil. There is good that is known by everyone, it's evil that's known by everyone. The question here, the easy rebuttal to this is, well, what mechanism did you use to ascertain this? How could you be objective in that mechanism over others? So that's a, you know, refutation in and of itself. So therefore, we have to accept something called moral relativism, which is that good and evil, what is good, what is bad, is something subjective. And it being subjective differs from time to place. What was acceptable 200 years ago may not be acceptable now. And then I went into the history of it as well. And you know, subhanAllah, you'll find even in England, okay, the marriage law was, I think it was made 1928, when the age, minimum age of marriage was raised to 16 years old. But before this, let's ask what happened before this. Right? The royal family themselves were marrying 6-year-old girls. 7-year-old girls, and I mentioned my sources in the paper, you can go and find it. Look at America, North America. Delaware, 6 years old. 7 years old. Majority of Europe, same thing. 100 years ago, 200 years ago, same thing. Look at the other religions, the Hindu scriptures, you'll find something similar to this. The Jewish traditions, in the Talmud, you'll find something similar to this. Christian, of course, the marriage of Mary and Joseph the carpenter. She was 11 years old. In fact, Islam, brothers, and pay attention to this, Islam is the only religion that actually put barriers in place to protect the female. SubhanAllah, what? How? Okay. Now, Islam put barriers to protect the female. We have legal maxims, qawa'id, fiqhiyah, in which Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported that he said, La darar wa darar. There is no harm to be caused, nor is there any reciprocating of harm. This is a principle agreed upon by all of the scholars of Islam, that if anything is to harm a person, whether it is physical harm, whether it is psychological harm, it is no longer permissible. So Islam put barriers in place. Even if a female was 20, 30, 40 years old, if she was to marry and consummate this marriage, if it was to cause her harm, it is not permissible for it to be consummated and for the marriage to occur. Why? In order to protect her. So out of all of the major world religions and world views, Islam came to protect the female, and it came to honor the female in life, which history has never seen before and will never see in the future. Why? Because this is a divine religion. Allah says, who knows best for the one who created? أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. The one who created, doesn't he know? The one who created, doesn't he know what is good for his creation? And he is the sublime, the most well-informed. So go back to this paper, inshaAllah ta'ala, read it, and hopefully benefit from it, and spread it if you find it beneficial. وَجَزَاكُمْ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا وَجَزَاكُمْ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا.